Thank you for downloading Volume 2, Episode 3, making this Episode 23 of Is That Your Kid Podcast. Welcome to another week of our shenanigans. You're here with the two original Chain Gang Janglers. Todd, Tondera, also Jake Zerme, my co-host on the other side of my table, and always slightly above me and to my right, as I always like
traditionally,
it. Traditionally to my right, that's how we set things up.
You're always to my right, slightly.
Yeah, so we are right-handed, so our power side is our right side, so we keep each other on our power side.
Power friend, power right.
Better than left side.
Interesting, I think I'm wearing the same shirt as last week's podcast.
Really?
I think so.
I might be wearing the same, because I wear these shorts when I'm here. Not when I go out, but you see me in these shorts a lot when I'm here. But we are Is That Your Kid Podcast, nerds from Western Pennsylvania. We host a variety show while struggling to cope with one another's personality flaws. It's like Seinfeld, only worse. You can hit us up on at Is That Your Kid on Twitter, isthatyourkid.tumblr.com, isthatyourkid@yahoo.com, and Jake... Another week of the podcast. This is our third episode of Volume 2.
Can you believe it?
How are you feeling over there?
We've made it this far. I'm great. I got some coffee, as is another tradition.
Uh-huh.
Let's get some... Yep, I'm spilling it on me for the sake of getting that on the mic.
Did you spill the coffee on? Is it still
hot? At the gas station when I was there, this is how much I needed coffee. I stuck it under the thing. This is my own mug.
Mm-hmm.
I just get a refill, and they're always fine with it. I put it under the thing, and I didn't take the lid off. I just held it down.
Ooh.
And I'm wondering why it was getting all over my hands. So, definitely needed some coffee today. It was a late night last night. We were celebrating one of our friends who was here last week with us.
Mike Slobodian's birthday.
Lil Dick Mike, happy birthday, brother.
Mike Slobodian.
Yeah, actually, his real name is Mike Slobodian. He's our great friend.
Great friend of the show. I was out with him part one of the night. You were with him part two.
That is interesting. We were.
Part one of the night, we went to see Future Islands at Mr. Small's Theater in Pittsburgh. And I danced my little ass off. And it is tiny. That's not just a phrase when you
say... Were people getting into it? Was it packed there?
Some people were getting... I mean, people were getting into it in their own way. A lot of different age... like, a different age group. There's anybody from, like, 16 to, like, 36 there.
It's a pretty big spread, I suppose.
Yeah, so I enjoyed all the spread. I did my typical thing. I got, like, Jack and Coke, which, yeah, that is soda, but Jack and Coke... Double Jack and Coke. I drowned two of those down my gullet at the beginning of the show and then went up front, so that was pretty good.
Well, that's such a weird venue. You're not allowed to take your drinks up front.
Well, it's nuts because right before they played, there was a couple to my left of me. They were older, and I didn't want to be, like, rude, but they had a drink right up front, and she had it on the banister, and I wasn't going to rat her out or anything, but I was like, hey, you better, like, you know, try to hide that because they'll take that. And she's like, oh, no, they took down the banister.
What?
And I was like, really?
So the soundboard is not right in the middle
of
the
room? No. It was, but I'm saying as the show progressed, they didn't care if people brought drinks to the front. So she's like, yeah, you could go get a drink.
So you just need to be cool about it.
Yeah, just be chill. And they'll let you
in. See, that changes everything.
That changes everything, so I didn't really
Before,
need to do that.
They used to make you stand about, 35 feet back into the drinking section.
And I'm never going to be there. I'm never going to be 35.
No, and why would you be if it's a band you like? Be a little bit closer than that.
Yeah, like
that's like going to see going
28
to
feet. Would you say
sitting in the back row?
Would you say 28 feet is a comfortable feat?
I'd say if you're within the sixth or seventh row of people,
I'd get in a nose length away.
I know that you like to be up front, but I say if you don't have that option, if you're within the sixth people row,
mm-hmm.
you're fine.
Mm-hmm. So I was with Mike the first part of the night, and he
came over to Big Mike's, Mike Metrovich's place, and celebrated the only way that our friend group really knows how,
by playing board games and drinking, probably.
We did both of those.
And Instagramming.
I don't think maybe.
Maybe.
I think you guys got all the Instagramming out for the Future Islands.
Yeah.
Show.
But I did have a good time. But I did bring up whiskey, but we all know that whiskey isn't our favorite drink of the podcast. It's, of course, Tito's Vodka, our partnership here for Volume 2. Tito's Vodka, distilled 6 times, never 7, out of Austin, Texas, American-made. And I want every real American that could hear my voice to stand up put your right hand over your heart and say with me, loud in a loud and clear voice, we the people, America's vodka, Tito's vodka. And actually, I've got some vodka facts for you. I know not all of our listeners are avid drinkers such as ourselves. We have some straight-edge drinkers out there. So they say, Todd and Jake, why would I buy Tito's vodka? Well, Tito's vodka has a lot inside the bottle that you could use outside the bottle, and not just for drinking. So today's vodka facts bring you, if you listened to episode 19, this is where I give you facts on something. It was pizza facts before. Some weird moth hitting my window or something, I hear.
I think someone's breaking glass in the front street.
Okay. McKeesport, PA, we break glass in the front street. But so, Jake, these vodka facts are coming in hot, okay? Coming in hot.
Hot as a medium pizza at a laundromat.
Yes, yes, you get the bit. So these are either true or false. I'll state a vodka fact, and you tell me if, you know, if it's real or fake. So vodka facts, at Tito's Vodka on Twitter. Add a few drops of vodka to vase water, and the liquor makes the flowers you put in it age slower. So
they'll last longer.
They'll last longer. So if you put a couple drops of vodka into vase water and put flowers in it, the flowers will last longer.
False.
True. True, bro. So for all you...
Distilled six times will keep your flowers pretty.
It's not distilled six times for its health, bro. It's for the health of others. In that vase water, put some flowers in that vase... They'll live longer.
Dr. Steve Brule, for your plant's health.
For your plant's health. For your vodka health. But, at Tito's Vodka on Twitter. At Is That Your Kid on Twitter. At Tito's Vodka on Twitter. At Is That Your Kid on Twitter. Tell us how you drink your Tito's. And this episode will be filled with vodka facts. And that's only one of them. And
should we have Russian accents?
I can't do any accents.
All right.
You can if you want. But do you want another one real quick?
I was more thinking, how so does the vodka, like, cleanse the water, make it pure?
There's no telling what
it
does.
Are these internet facts?
There's, yeah.
So they're still 50-50, okay.
Nah, they're real.
So they're still...
They're 100% real.
About 60-40.
All right, put a dab of vodka on a piece of cloth, and you're able to clean your glasses to the best ability.
True.
How about that?
It's basically rubbing alcohol.
So, straight edge people out there, people who don't drink alcohol, put some vodka in that vase water. Put some vodka on a cloth and wipe off your damn dirty glasses.
Listeners out there that don't drink vodka but still would like to support Is That Your Kid or Tito's, buy a bottle, dump out all the vodka except for a little bit, put water in it, and then put your flowers in the bottle.
Successful.
And it'll already be clean.
Mm-hmm. But we have a jam-packed episode today. We were even talking about that before the episode started, that we had a lot of segments planned, and we don't even know if we're going to get to all the segments today, and mostly because we're going to just yam on about nothing.
Maybe. I'm out of coffee.
Out of coffee.
Might want to wrap it up soon.
Okay. That's been this episode of Is That Your Kid? Jake, take it away. False. That's not a good joke. So we're going to keep...
9 minutes in.
Keep going forward.
Let's wrap it up.
Wrap it up. We've both had some busy weeks today. Well, busy weeks this week, not just today.
Yeah.
If anybody is a friend of me on Instagram, you could follow me, Todd Tondera on Instagram, my personal account. You have found out that I was in another car accident this week.
That's it, Todd. And tell everyone, what's that tally? You're 27.
26 still.
You're 26. How many car accidents have you been in?
Probably a half dozen.
That's a lot.
I've probably caused one and a half. One I've definitely caused. The other one I was just involved in and nobody else was involved in.
So out of six, you're at like maybe 18% your fault.
Yeah.
Out of 100%. Not bad.
Yeah, so if you saw my Instagram, you know that I was in the hospital yesterday.
In a neck brace.
In a neck brace, right. And I did take a self-portrait of myself at the hospital, as I traditionally do. If you look in the back catalog of my life, you will see at least 2 to 3 other hospital self-portraits.
I think those maybe are fan favorites, because the last time you were in there, man, your eyes were so black and blue.
Yeah.
You might have looked dead.
I was really messed up the last time I was in there. This time, fortunately...
It's been a long time, though.
This is the second time I've been in the hospital this year, which is actually pretty good.
I meant...
Car accident-wise.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it has been, you know, I was about to fill my, you know, it was just about that time I needed to get into one. So
we got it out of the way for 6 months.
Yeah, another six
You're
months.
Good.
But I don't know what all I could say about it, because it still hasn't settled, because I'm still working with my insurance and the other cars involved. So I don't want to say too much condemning stuff on the podcast, but I will say what happened, because this is what exactly happened. Well, not
all right.
Well, not exactly. Well, yes, exactly. We'll put that out there. This is what fucking happened. I was on my way to work in the morning. I was heading downtown. I was about to get to the south side in Pittsburgh. If you know, where the get-go is before you get into the south side? Like, it's right by the FBI building.
Okay. All right, yeah.
By the ice cream shop, maybe.
Ooh, I haven't been there in a while.
Do you know where that is, though? Mm-hmm. Right in front of there by the red light there. At where East Carson meets Bex Run Road.
So were you coming home like Buttermilk Hollow way?
I was going through Homestead, past that way.
Oh, okay.
Homestead, then through the south side. I was sitting in my car, and all of a sudden, there was an impact from behind, a rear impact, from behind, and my head slammed off the back of my headrest, and my neck immediately felt craned.
craned
ass neck, and
immediately felt like I'd just been in a car accident.
Yeah, immediately felt like I've been in a car accident. And you know me, like, immediately I was just like, you gotta be fucking kidding me. Like, okay, what now, what's going on now? And I got hit from behind, and then I was pushed into the vehicle in front of me. He had a trailer hitch on his Jeep, so the trailer hitch went into my front bumper. And the gentleman got out with his passenger and just looked at me and threw his hands in the air. He's like, what are you doing? And I just, like, apathetically, like, pointed, like, dude, like, behind me. Like, not me, behind me. Because I was still in my car because I was just, like, kind of woozy. And he's like, well, let's pull over at the ice cream shop. And so there was four cars involved in that. A woman hit into this car behind me. That car hit me. And then I was pushed into a Wrangler. Mm. Now, what's
wow, that's a lot of, and you
four
all
cars.
Had your brakes on.
Four cars. The Wrangler did, I did. I can't speak for the car behind me for sure, because I didn't see what happened, but there was a car behind the car behind me that hit that car. So there was four cars, and we all pulled over and exchanged information, and
And then you all unanimously decided that it was that person in the fucking back.
Well, right, because they did it.
Yeah.
I mean, that's not, that's who did it.
Yeah, obviously.
But I had to do, like, several recorded statements, because their insurance, I wouldn't be surprised if one of their insurance company while live on the pod, because they're just like, okay, Mr. Tondera, we're going to record this, so say what happened. And they've been doing that, and they've been asking me, like, weird questions, just like, you know, of course I was, you know, they're like, did you have any drugs or alcohol in your system? And I'm just like, well, of course not, no. That no, I don't do that. And it's just like, okay, fine. But like, say I did. Say I was just blitzed out of my mind, okay? I was not moving. My car wasn't moving. Say I was. Say I was the drunkest I've ever been. You still caused the accident. Like, why are we even talking about, you know, this is like pulling teeth with this. But no, I was not under the influence of anything. I was, I had my foot on the brake sitting there, and I was slammed from behind.
What were you listening to?
A podcast, Tell 'Em Steve Dave podcast, episode 149, flashback. It was a clip show that I really liked. I do enjoy that. And, so I went to the hospital, and precautionary measures, cause I said I hit my head and I craned my neck, and they're like, a craned neck. And I was like, yeah. And so they put me in a neck brace, all that bit. And, I went through, they like took x-rays and stuff, and they just said I had a concussion, just to take it easy, but there's no damage, so I could do anything I want with
my
neck.
Yeah, his neck is moving all over the place.
Yeah, I could do whatever.
Gingerly,
though. Yeah, I could do, like, it's sore, but there's nothing wrong with it, if you know what I mean. Like, there's no... It's just sore. Yeah. It's sore.
Well, you got a craned-ass neck,
I got a craned neck, but I do have a concussion. And I've had far worse concussions than this. And as Steve, remember Steve?
Right on concrete.
Steve from Baby and I.
Yeah, he went on board to say that it was a contusion. He had a contusion.
He had a head contusion. And he's never come back from that. He's never come back from that head contusion. He'll tell you that flat out. He'd say, I never came back from that head contusion.
I still see specters.
Yeah, he's still Steve from Baby sees specters about it.
We'll speak for him and we can say that he sees
Steve,
specters.
Steve, email in and tell us the specters you see from that head contusion.
What kind of specters are they?
What kind are they? But he's also went on record to say you could smell your own parts. You could smell your blood and you could smell iron. All that's true. I've gotten concussions before where I've lost a day. Like, I kind of came to, not that I was knocked out, but I kind of came to, and I was just like, in reality, I was like, holy shit, where did today go? That never happened with this. I lost probably 10 minutes. But, that was my week.
I'm glad you're okay.
Yeah?
I don't think that would have happened to anyone else.
No. Well, yeah, it did. It happened to three other people. But, yeah.
I know.
Uh-huh.
With already another 5 car accidents. Before that.
Yeah, I think about
maybe
5.
Not accidents, car stuff.
Well, some of them, yeah. But again, really, the reason why I say I've caused 1.5 car wrecks, because one I did, firmly I did. And the other one, it was just with me in it, so I didn't hit anyone else. So it was just like, that's like, wasn't my fault, sure, but I made sure not to hit anyone.
I gotcha.
There's been other accidents where I've done nothing. I've not... My car was sitting out front my house that one time, remember, this year?
it was just sideswiped,
and I went out to...
I think we talked about that.
...to meet my car there, and that's why that we met Chris Gethard at the Greyhound station in a rental car.
Because
of that. So, with us today, I would not miss a podcast today, even if that happened this morning. I would be here and back. We the people, right? We the people, Jake.
Okay.
But you know what?
I could visit you in the hospital. I could record it there.
Dude, next time I'm in the hospital, which will be, I'm sure.
Get 5-7 months.
7 months. Let's record it in the hospital.
All right.
So let's make a note next time I'm there to record it. But really, if you rubber soak your feet in vodka, it eliminates the odor.
True.
Vodka fact.
True.
True, that's correct. Rubber soak your feet in vodka to eliminate the odor. Tito's Vodka, at Tito's Vodka on Twitter, titosvodka.com, our partner for this volume's episodes.
Pop, pop.
Vodka facts. Three vodka facts in a row that are true. How are you feeling about all of them?
Pretty good. And now I'm wondering if Sylvester Stallone has ever had a drink of vodka.
Sylvester Stallone? I'm sure he does. I'm sure he only drinks Tito's. What else would he drink?
Yeah, I think he was tweeting about that the other day.
He probably eats, like, shoe leather and drinks Tito's. And that's what he does.
Yeah, hangs out with, Jason Statham nowadays.
They eat...
And make Expendables movies.
He eats leather, like, chips. Just leather pieces he cuts out.
Oh, man. I love chips.
With a dull knife. Yeah.
I don't think I'd like leather chips, though.
I don't know.
You know I love chips.
Mm-hmm. But we are drinking a little bit today, as you hear.
My coffee's done.
Of course, this is Tito's.
Mmm.
That fresh Tito's taste.
I didn't get in an accident, but I did get in trouble.
Oh.
On Monday.
Okay. Do tell.
Well, I got a ticket, and it's right here. I have it.
You brought a ticket today?
Yep. This Monday, I went with... I went to Deep Creek.
Okay.
And visit some people out there with Aaron, obviously. Okay. And we went out, her and I, and she was visiting some relatives, basically. And Deep Creek, Maryland, right on the lake.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful place. It was a perfect day. It was like today. It was wonderful out there. Her relatives rent this for a week. Like this gorgeous lake home.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly nothing I will ever be able to afford, so I just have to mooch off other people.
Yeah.
So I'm out there trying to be as gracious as possible, trying not to get in the way, trying to be helpful, like, thank you for letting me use your beautiful dock and boat and eat your food here. So
your beautiful dog.
Your beautiful dog. So we're out there, and the man, the gentleman that owns it, he says, "You know what, Jake? Do you wanna take the jet ski out?" Where my reply was, "Absolutely." So I'm like, "Dude, yeah." And they're nice. They're Ski-Doo, brand new.
Uh-huh.
They look like
Kenny Powers from Eastbound and Down.
Is that a car?
Pontiac Aztec? Yeah, I'm sure it is.
There is a car called an Aztec. I don't know if it's Pontiac, but it's real edgy and weird looking. Real cool looking jet skis. Man, they have some giddy up. And I'll tell you, I was on that jet ski about a solid minute and a half, and I got pulled over by the water police.
You got pulled over on a jet ski?
By water police.
What? There's water police?
There's lake police.
Lake?
And it wasn't the game commission, like the Maryland game commission. It was police.
So you were driving a jet ski and
illegally,
you were pulled over.
Obviously, because I don't have a boating license.
Yeah.
And in Maryland, I guess you need one.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, I had a blast for about a minute and a half. About a minute and a half, and then I got pulled over. They tell me to cut the engine. I said, because like if you let go of the throttle, the jet ski still idles.
Yeah.
In forward motion, probably about like 3 or 4 miles an hour,
yeah,
which on the water is pretty substantial, but it allows you to turn even when you're not throttling.
Yeah.
So he said, cut the engine. And I said, all right. And I cut the engine and I said, I can't turn. And we're like,
yeah,
15 feet away at this point. Cause I'm riding. He probably thought I was drunk. I wasn't.
Yeah.
Cause I was, my smile was touching my ears.
A part dog.
I was having the best time. And I see these two guys waving me down.
Mm-hmm.
So I immediately slow down, let go of the throttle, listen to what they say, cut the engine. I cut the engine. They say, all right, come on over here. So like, I can't steer. You told me to cut the power. And they're like, okay. And they just keep coming at me. Mm-hmm. And they hit into me on this other person's jet ski. I was like, whoa, whoa, whoa. And they're like, oh, sorry about that. And they like grab hold of the jet. They like rammed me.
And you weren't doing anything.
I cut the power. Like, I can't steer. And I'm sitting there.
Dude.
And they came in and hit me.
Dude.
And I think that's how I got off easy, but I didn't want to spoil the story, but I might have. So here's my ticket. Notice of violation, State of Maryland, Natural Resources Police, Annapolis, Maryland. 21401. And, of course, I gave
them would have that fucking pig's badge hitting into me like that.
It wasn't a ram, but it was a definite bump. It was a definite bump, and it wasn't my jet ski. I'm like, oh, man, this guy's his jet ski. Number one, I'm thinking.
We need John Miller here because he hates police on Facebook.
I don't have a boating license.
Yeah.
You need one of those to ride a jet ski.
Yeah.
So right off the bat, fine.
Yeah.
Fine. Immediately, as soon as they bump into me, I'm like, this is a fine. Yeah. Now they think I'm an asshole because they rammed into me. So here we go. It happened on the 4th of August. 2:40 p.m.
Did you give them a business card?
I didn't have it with me.
Okay.
I had on my teal swimsuit.
Yeah.
With a pink and teal life jacket.
I gave my nurse one.
So I had I had a life jacket on, life preserver. First thing he asked me, "All right, you got a whistle on, you got a horn on that thing?" And I had been on this thing for a minute and a half. And I, of course, went into straight bluff mode. Uh-huh. Absolutely. It's right here. It's this red button. They're like, oh, can you hit it for us? I'm like, well, it doesn't work. I don't know if that was it or not. I still don't know if it had a horn.
Wow. But, that was thinking on your feet.
And
though.
They're like, yeah, it's right here. It's this red button. And they're like, well, hit it. I'm like, oh, it only works when it's on. So I'm like, oh, I can't do it. And then I'm like, well, I have a whistle here. And the whistle is attached to the keys.
Yeah.
So, like, if anything happens. And you attach the key
to
your life vest. It just gets better to your life vest. So if you fall off, it immediately turns off. So, like, if you fall off the jet ski, the key
And this
comes
is
off.
All just shooting from the hip.
Well, still don't know. You're supposed to attach it. So I'm like, yeah, I got my whistle here, too. They're like, okay. Next thing I'm going to have to ask you was, does it have a fire extinguisher? I'm like, yeah, of course. And I'm like, yeah, of course.
Dude, this is the best story.
He's like, well, where is it? I'm like, it's under the seat. Again, no idea. I'm just like, yeah, it's under the seat. And they're like, oh, okay. You want to get it out? I'm like, yeah.
Oh, this is so sick.
So I stand up, right? And I'm like, on the water. And they have like, these jet skis are pretty big. They're like 400 freaking pounds.
Yeah.
But so I could stand on the side. And I'm like trying to get the seat up. It said lift.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, it's under here, and I can't get it right now, and I couldn't. because it says lift, and I was trying to lift it, and I could tell, like, the plastic was bending.
Yeah.
And I didn't want to, like, do that.
It wasn't how, it wasn't the way you do it.
No, but. And I'm just like, okay, all right. And we're like, we'll figure that out in a little bit. So I'm like, what? I'm like, phew, that was a close one.
Yeah.
Because, again, I don't know if they had a fire extinguisher on a jet ski. Is that something you do?
I don't know.
I was still.
Write us it. Is that your kid to tell us?
UCB Theater, if you want my improv skills, this is it. Here we go. So I'm like, all right, yeah. So every time I talk to the police, which granted isn't a lot, but every time I talk to the police, they think I'm giving them a fake name. My last name's Zerme, and then when I start to spell it, they immediately think I'm lying to them, making up this wacky ass name.
They want Gordon is what they want. Jake Gordon.
So I start I spell out my name for him, and he immediately calls it in. Like, I'm going to need a check on I'm going to need a 27 on a 39. Here we go. And they're like,
I need a 27 on a 39.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, I've been working on that.
Nice. So he calls in my name. He goes, and one of the first things, you know, do you have a boating license?
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah, of course. No, he didn't ask me that. I'm sorry. Let's back up. Yeah. He asked me, do you have a license to be on that thing? I'm like, yeah. It's on shore, though. We just got off from water skiing.
This is so sick.
So.
This is so alternative. I love it.
So he was like, I was like, because it's not my place. I don't want to get them in trouble.
Yeah.
This is the first week that my host was there. This is the first day that he's there. This could have maybe ruined his week. So I'm just trying not to ruin anything.
Yeah.
So first thing he asked me is, you know, do you have a license for this? And I'm like, yeah, of course. But we just got off. I hopped on for like just a couple minutes. And it's on shore, and I didn't want to lose it because I don't have like pockets. He's like, all right, I guess so. So he looks up my real driver's license.
Yeah.
So my thing is bluffing to him that I had a boating license because he left it sort of like up in the air, like ambiguous. He was like, "Do you have a license?" And of course, I have a driver's.
I see. So if he cornered me on it,
yeah, I was like, "Yeah, of course, my driver's. That's what you need, right?" I would have just played dumb at that point.
Yeah.
But it didn't go that far.
You had a loophole. You had a way out. I'm proud of you because that's what I do.
So if you would have cornered me like, no, a boating license. Oh, boating license. No, I don't have one of those. I definitely have a real license, though. That's where I would have gone.
Yeah.
But he took all my stuff down. He gave me this. The owner of the lake house and jet skis and dock stuff drove out to us on his other jet ski. He said, whoa, hey, guys, everything okay here? I turn around, said to his name's Doug. I said, yeah, Doug, everything's fine. And they're like, yeah, everything's okay. And he goes, all right, well, I'm just checking. I'm like, yeah.
Dude, this is the best story I've heard all summer. I love this.
Doug is like, is he going to need a ride back? I'm like, nah, I think I'm all right.
And then, oh, that's so good because you presumptively closed.
Yeah, and they're like,
he
should be able to ride himself back. I'm like, all right, well, I'll see you back there, Doug. And he's like, okay.
Dude, that was such a sick presumptive close because you're just like, no, everything's cool. Because if you were been like, they pulled me over, I don't know. You were just like, yeah, I think so. You know,
and
I
then
should be good.
As they're calling in my name, checking to make sure if I'm a real person, I'm a real boy, I start talking to the other gentleman. I'm like, so what's Deep Creek, you know, run off into? And he tells me, like, well, it doesn't really run off, but the dam leaks out into the Youghiogheny. I'm like, oh, I'm from Pittsburgh. We got one of those. We got one of those Youghiogheny's.
This is so good.
And I'm like, man, Youghiogheny, it gets pretty shallow. It gets, like, as shallow as, like, 5 feet in some places. And he's like, yeah. So we're talking about that and talking about all the rivers. And I'm like, yeah, you know what? I'm sorry about the dock. Because in Pittsburgh, we just ride around on the river. And you could just do whatever you want as long as you're not near anything of an import or by the bridges. He's like, oh, well, all right. The whole thing is they said that I was a little bit close to shore and I was going a little bit too fast. But the thing is, Deep Creek's crowded, man.
Mm-hmm.
There's people on water skis.
So you're just saying, I wasn't used to that.
I was getting out of the way.
Yeah.
I was getting out of the way of them. So I was sticking kind of close to shore, but not dangerous. I'm not going to, like, kill anyone. But it's a PWC. I was close. I was over 6 knots within 100 feet of docks.
Over 6 slip knots.
Over 6 knots is a nautical term for speed.
Yeah.
It's basically the same thing as miles per hour. Fun fact. It's not too far off from actual miles per hour.
So over six, that's not a lot.
Well, you're in an idle wake zone. They don't want you thrashing. They don't want you thrashing.
Just slamming,
But that'd be like from here to your neighbor's house. I was farther than that, and they pulled me over. So that was my whole thing, and they did let me go. They gave me this written warning. Not a fine. I did not pay anything.
Nice.
They didn't have to go back and check They didn't come on shore to see nice. My boating license. And I had a great story, embarrassing story to tell everyone there. That's great. They were flabbergasted. They're like,
dude,
so what happened?
Speechless.
What
I'm
happened? I'm like, nothing happened. They're like, what do you mean? I'm like, no, everything's fine. They're like, how? I'm like, well, I don't know.
I got a warning. Everything was cool, but that fucking part where you were just like, nah, everything's cool. I'm fine. Don't worry about it. Like, that just, like, you, that was a presumptive close. Like you're letting the officers know, like,
that I wasn't.
We talked.
That everything was fine.
And everything's cool, because I think if you would have been like, hey, I don't know what's going on, come on over, you know.
I'm real freaked out right now.
I'm real freaked out. Yeah. They'd been like, why are you freaked out? But you're like, nah, everything should be good. Yeah, just head
back. That was how I almost got arrested on a jet ski. But.
Best story you've ever told, I feel, on this podcast.
You know what? I left that apart. We did pick up the seat. And guess what? There was a fire extinguisher under there. And you know what? Even weirder, the older officer, mm-hmm. his name's Glenn. Oh, shit, his name's... No, that's a fake name. Should we say it?
we'll cut it. I'll cut it. I'll cut that. We won't put his name in. His name was Glenn.
His name was Glenn. Just beep him. Can we beep them?
Yeah.
His name is Glenn...
Do you want me to thunderclap it, or
are there ocean sounds?
I don't know if there is.
But we definitely shouldn't say the officer's name. But his name was Glenn.
He seems like a nice guy, honestly.
And you know what? He was.
I take back. I wouldn't have had his badge.
Glenn wanted me to shoot the fire extinguisher on the water. He's like, just make sure it works. I'm like, no, that's not mine to use. And it still has a safety pin. And he's like, well, let's just try it anyway. And he's like pushing the button. And I'm standing right there. And I'm like, Glenn, you need to chill out. I didn't say that, but I'm thinking in my mind, like, why are you trying to shoot this fire extinguisher right now?
Yeah.
So we closed it all back up, and that's pretty much when it wrapped up, and then I drove back. I said, I'm good to go? He said, all right, have a nice day.
Nice.
So
he just had some questions, and you had some answers, was what it came down to. That's a presumptive close. I love that. I love that bit. So have it be known that that's my favorite Jake story. Episode 23 is my favorite Jake story ever. So if we do a best of volume 2, this line that I'm speaking right now, here, this is what we'll do. That was my favorite Jake story ever. Back to you guys. Now leave a pause here.
That's for later.
And that's for later. So when we do best of volume 2, that was on it. Dude, that was fantastic that you had the opportunity to put yourself in that situation and then take yourself
completely
out.
Completely lie to the law.
Yeah, I like that. I you've come a long way.
Great job. Here's me actually not jet skiing, but water skiing behind the boat.
Oh, I didn't see that. That's cool. I like
it
that.
It took me a lot of tries, and I'll tell you, this part, I want you to flex and grab.
Like this?
As hard as you can, like squeeze.
Okay.
Your fingers together. Feel those muscles like right here?
Yeah, I'm going
to
throw up.
Those are the only muscles that you need to jet ski, and that's the best and worst thing.
Nice.
Because up until yesterday, and I went on Monday, mind you, this part of my arm is still sore. Opening doors, hard. It hurt.
No good.
It was sore. Mm-hmm. So I did water ski for the first time successfully. Mm-hmm. On
your favorite kind of, your second favorite kind of sore. Your first would be a dinosaur.
Ooh, I like that too. I dig that.
And see, that conversation didn't get lost on me. I know you like dinosaurs, and I know that's a concern of yours.
It is. And don't ever shy away from talking about dinosaurs with me.
I won't. So that's why I said your second favorite sore. My favorite sore would probably be, Mega, well, no, that's a Zord. I was going to say Megazord.
I'll take it.
Okay, my favorite, Mega, how about we call it Megazord?
Because isn't the red one a dinosaur?
A dinosaur.
Yeah.
I really liked Power Rangers.
Yeah, the first run was fucking so great.
Mm-hmm. So, do you think, Glenn, do you think that, he was, much of a father of the law? Or do you think he was...
I think, and you know why? I do believe so.
Mm-hmm.
Glenn was an older gentleman in his 50s.
Mm-hmm.
The other officer with him, or should I say officer in training with him.
Ooh.
With him.
So he had a job or
he
officer
was younger than
him.
Me.
Mm-hmm.
He was probably, say, 22, 23.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was not like a training exercise, but maybe. Because the little guy didn't say too much. He just kind of hung back and observed.
Mm-hmm.
So it could have been like a routine thing.
You kind of got over on him, so he wouldn't be...
But I was talking to the little one while the older, where Glenn was doing his business, like on the radio. So
Oh, were you talking? What were you talking about? College, maybe? Like, oh,
no, that's who I was
up.
Talking to the Yakigani about the Yakigani too. So
that's pretty sick.
That was at Deep Creek, wonderful place. I swam in a lake. It's called Jennings Randolph Lake, completely private.
Jennings Randolph. That's like a Madden football player name.
You can look it up. It's shaped like a Chinese dragon, like a Chinese zodiac dragon.
Not on purpose.
Nature has hardly anything on purpose, really.
Dude, that's so
But it was
deep.
Beautiful. You could see about 15 feet down,
mm-hmm.
and you could just swim. The water was like 80 degrees. It was a beautiful time. We'd jump off the boat, and then we'd get back down and motor around, mm-hmm. jet ski around. Then we'd take a break, put on life preservers, and just float out in the lake. It was incredible.
How
if you ask
murky
me,
was the lake?
That's what I'm saying. You could see 15 feet down at Jennings Randolph.
Could you see fish at all?
Yeah.
Okay.
They're within 15 feet down.
You see any big guys?
Nope.
You see little ones like bluegill?
I wasn't really trying to find big guys because then I wouldn't love the lake as much.
Yeah, I wouldn't find any big guys.
But Deep Creek, murky, but only because it's used more. There's always people churning up the water. But this other private one we went to,
mm-hmm.
when I water skied, not jet skied, when I water skied, mm-hmm. beautiful.
I
would go back. If you asked me, Jake, here's a free vacation to the beach.
You would
here's a free vacation to Deep Creek and all that.
Mm-hmm.
I would honestly take Deep Creek because I've been to the ocean a whole lot. Mm-hmm. I've been to the ocean a lot.
Yeah.
I'm thankful to say mm-hmm. I've been to the ocean probably about 10 times in my life, mm-hmm. which
so,
is pretty good. 10 or 11 times.
I've probably been there 3 or 4.
So, I'll take a lake. So, that's my Sunday and Monday.
Water police stuff. Water police and car accidents.
You should either be impressed with my improv skills or disappointed in my lying skills. Disappoint.
I'm not disappointing in anything.
You should be
you've
disappointed
done.
That I'm that good at lying.
I'm not disappointing in anything you've done. That was like the best story. Like I could hear that over. Like if you retold it, I'd still listen the second time. I loved it so much. But speaking about improv skills, Jake, you know what's coming up next week.
We're heading to New York City.
We are heading to the Big Apple.
The Big Apple.
The Big Apple. New York City, and I'm pretty anxious about it, only because the last time I was there, like...
you had the serious flu?
I had the flu, but...
Was
so...
it the last time? No,
was it?
You've been there before.
Oh, no, you know what?
You've been
I
there
lied.
Since.
I just lied on podcast. Yeah, I was there last August. I went there last May, and that's when I had the flu. Last August, I was only there, like, overnight, though.
Mm-hmm.
But Jake and I are going to New York again. Jake and Todd's trip to New York, August 13th. Yeah. We come back on the 16th. Let me bring up the times here.
I'm excited, man. I haven't been to the Big Apple since 2005.
Mm-hmm.
That's, oh, wow. That's almost like 10 years.
So post 9/11.
Yes.
So post 9/11. Yes. Okay. That just reminded me of the... Between Two Ferns with Zach Galifianakis and Michael Cera. When Michael Cera
we
said
were just
he
thinking
to New
York. we're gonna maybe stay with Ryan or hang out with Ryan.
Yeah.
What we called Ryan last night.
Ryan's been on episode 15 of the show.
We called him last night and we were just saying that this summer, this September is gonna be his first 9/11 in New York City.
First 9/11.
It's his first 9/11 that goes by.
Uh huh. And there's the Freedom Tower is already up and it's beautiful.
Pop.
Beautiful.
Hey, you know what they found underneath of that? This is great. You know what they found underneath when the towers, when they were clearing the rubble? Obviously, they found an old-ass ship from, like, the Revolutionary War. Did you know this?
So, under the rubble.
Yes.
From the towers.
And
do
you know
why?
Because man-made, they extended Manhattan to give it more land. But they just put anything down there. Junk. They, like, there's this old beat-up ship from the Revolutionary War, and when they were trying to extend Manhattan, they just sank it to create, like, land, to build shit on top of it.
They've
so there's
that.
An old, yeah, there's an old, old, and the wood dates back to around the time of Revolutionary War.
Right.
It was the, whatever it was, cedar or whatever it would have been. But they found also more planks
mm-hmm.
that would have been, like, not Monticello's, like, what am I thinking of? Oh, from Philadelphia.
Okay.
It's wood from Philadelphia, which is why I read it in the newspaper,
mm-hmm.
which is why it was even in a Pennsylvania, like, local newspaper.
So that would
because
be...
Because it's wood from Philly.
So, they're saying around... I mean, when was the Revolutionary War? Like, 17... This is bad. I should know this probably. Like, what? 1770 to, like, 1780, 85, maybe? So, around there?
I can't claim to know for certain... But pretty old, man. But over 200 years, easily.
Yeah, I'm gonna guess that it was like around like 17, like late 1700s, I would say 1770-ish.
Yeah.
But I don't know if that's the important part. Mm. But the important part is the fact that that was down there. I never knew that. Was it like,
I didn't know that they just used junk to just like fill in the landfill to make Manhattan bigger.
Well, I guess, what's that comic that you read for a while that I read for a little bit? Great Pacific?
Yeah.
Yeah. That kind of reminds me of that, where it's like a junk island.
Yeah.
Was it just parts of it, or do they have, like, did they bring that out and they have...
No, they're, ship? Like, they were, like, doing, like, an archaeological, like, yeah. A dig site where yeah. they were taking it apart piece by piece.
That's sweet.
Yeah, it was still pretty much in, I mean, it's not perfect condition, but... I know. I read that in the newspaper. That's crazy that you just talked about that.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah.
But
so,
the Freedom Tower, I've not been to a completed...
1775, it
says. I didn't go to the Freedom Tower the last time, because I think it was just kind of finishing up, or... But I'd like to go. I'd like to go with you to that, because we're going to have a couple days, because I, you know...
Our days aren't completely booked. We're going to have to make our own fun, mm-hmm. for the most part.
And what we're going to arrive in New York at 7:05 p.m., roughly, on Wednesday, at 11 o'clock, we will be at the Chris Gethard Show at MNN Studios in Manhattan. Afterwards, we're going to be recording this podcast with a few friends of mine. Jake's going to meet up with them, and I assume that we'll be doing that directly after. So we're going to have a long day. Then on Thursday, we're going to Brooklyn to see some stand-up as well. And then on Friday, we're going to the UCB Theater. And we're going to see the Stepfathers, which is the improv comedy team there. And this will be my first show at the UCB, which I'm really, really excited for. I mean, it's probably the most exciting thing that I'm looking forward to. And not the last time I was in New York, but the time before that, when I went in May, I was actually going to a show at the UCB, and I had to cancel it because the person that I was hanging with, they couldn't go or didn't want to go. And I was just like, all right, then I couldn't go, because basically, in a nutshell, what had happened, that I made plans with somebody, and I was like, yeah, I thought we would go to the show, and they're like, no, I had no plans of going to that show. So I was either, like, bailing on them or bailing on the show, and I had already made plans with them. So it was just like, I couldn't be like, oh, you're helping me out, but, you know, I'm still going to bail and just kind of do my own thing.
Mm.
Yeah, so this is my first time at the UCB. Inside, at least. I've been there a couple times outside, so I'm really excited for that. And then on Saturday...
Now, is it going to be, like, an intimate setting? Is it going to be, like,
yeah,
pretty
it's,
small?
Yeah, it's a smaller theater.
I can't imagine it's too big.
No.
But it's very exciting, though.
Yeah, and then on Friday, we're going to be, coming home for about 20 after 5, and, the Seams play on, that night. So,
yeah.
We're going to have a long weekend.
I got to take my trumpet with me, man, to practice.
Yeah.
Keep my chops up.
We could do that.
If you don't play for a couple days, I'll have...
If you don't use it.
Weak lips.
If you lose it, if you don't use it, you lose it.
I don't want to let the band down, you know?
Yeah. And so it's going to be a lot of fun, and I hope everybody joins us. There's been people kind of hit me up on Facebook like, hey, when are you going to be here, blah, blah, blah. And I'm just like, you know, blah, blah, blah. And they're like, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, sweet, sweet, sweet. So hopefully we see our friend Ryan as well up there. But, you know, it's because it's already kind of getting into the summer. We actually want to do a podcast, too, where we sit by the fire. So maybe when we come back, we do a fireside podcast.
You could ask a couple friends to come join us again.
Maybe your dad could say hello to us as well.
As he does that, when we have fires, he comes out for about
three minutes. But I mean, great dad. We've called him the father of the year before, but really this show focuses on the father of something else. Now, doesn't it, Jake? The father of the week, right?
Father of the week.
So this week's segment of Father of the Week, I know we came back to it last week. I'm gonna give you a name and you tell me who it is, right? This is a lot like the father of Banana Republic.
Okay.
What does the name Tom Gilpatrick mean to you?
Football.
No, but Tom Gilpatrick is our father of the week.
I am the father
Now, I've been, I'm not going to lie, the past 3 weeks, I'd say, I've been into two things, doing two things, and I've been caught up on it. The show To Catch a Predator, been loving that. I've been.
You said that last week.
Oh,
and
did
I'm
I?
Like,
I forget.
No, 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 not here, but you just mentioned it in passing, and I'm like, what the
dude,
hell
I've
are
been,
you watching that show for?
I've been on, I've learned so much about the back, I'm an internet guy that will search anything on the internet. I've learned so much about that show and why it stopped, and it's pretty dark because somebody committed suicide.
Because of that show?
Because of that show. What? And there was a lawsuit, there was a bunch of stuff, and they actually, the guy never showed up, because the idea is that you, somebody acts like they're a 12-year-old to 14-year-old, and somebody flirts with them on the internet, and then they show
entrapment.
Up. Entrapment, right.
That's not cool.
Right, and so they come over to, you know, their house. Well, this guy didn't. He didn't meet, in a, like, make an appointment to come over to meet the, you know, the underage person. So they went to his house. They, like, the SWAT team went to his house. And as a SWAT, because he, like, backed off of it. He's like, nah.
So why was he in trouble if he didn't do anything?
So they went over to his house, and as they were approaching his house, he shot himself. Let that out there. Anyway.
To Catch a Predator, the show basically murdered someone.
Well,
they cornered him into killing himself. He said no, and then he was like, I'm not going to be a weirdo today.
But it's a crime to flirt with someone underage. You're sick if you're doing that.
I'm not supporting that.
All
right. But he didn't do any... it's messed up.
It is. No, I don't disagree.
He didn't advance it. He said, I'm done, and that's it.
Well,
maybe that's all he needed for that day.
Quote, unquote, he just disappeared. He was, like, flirting, and then he stopped. He may have sent them some pictures of himself, some pictures of his genitals, or whatever you do when you're a disgusting freak. Whatever you do.
Oh, man.
But, like,
that's
he just...
up.
He disappeared, and there was no contact or communication, so they went to him, and he shot himself. And so I believe it was his sister. Anyway, I don't know why I'm talking about this, because the other thing was the fact that I've been obsessed with finding more about the Bronies community. Dude, my mind just wonders. When my
so
mind...
We're this part of the show is now switched from normal podcast to anthropomorphic weird shit.
Yeah, like, my mind just will go, and that's like the best and worst thing about me, is like, my mind will just go on things. Like, I could get into something in 3 days' time and know all about it, but that's also stupid if it's stupid.
I visited the Wikipedia page, because there is, and I won't say it, but there is a student that is a proclaimed Brony.
You have a student that's a Brony.
He's got a My Little Pony t-shirt.
He's younger,
and other kids were like, yo, what's up with that? And he's like, yo, you know, it's My Little Pony.
Knock, knock. Like,
he's like, I'm into it, so
He trailer park boys them. He said, knock, knock, boys.
And you know
who's
what?
There?
He didn't care. He was like,
yeah.
So what? It's My Little Pony.
Who cares?
You know, and I was just like, I'm going to leave it at that.
Let's
move on.
But that's why I'm in full support of the community. So if you are a Brony or even a Pegasister, let us know. Because I want you on our podcast. I want to know more about it. I'm not saying I understand it, but it's not for me to understand.
No.
It's not for me to understand. But Tom Gilpatrick, to get back to the subject, Tom Gilpatrick had a son. His name was Lyle Gilpatrick. And Tom was real conservative. He didn't understand the movement. And he was like, he didn't want his son, just like a lot of American husbands, they don't want their son, like their, you know, 11, 12-year-old son into this, because they're just like, no,
yeah.
I don't want you doing this. This is for little girls, etc., etc. But BronyCon was coming up, and Lyle really wanted to go, and he really felt like that he would go. You know, it would open up a lot of doors for him socially, you know, for his father, everything else. So Tom... he actually spoke with another Brony dad, and he spoke with John DeLancey, who plays Q on Star Trek Next Generation. He also plays the quote-unquote villain Discord in My Little Pony's Friendship is Magic. He plays the villain in it.
The villain's name is Discord.
Discord.
That sounds like a bad guy.
No, that's what I'm saying, the villain.
Yeah, I know. It's a good name.
And so Tom and his wife took his son to BronyCon, and Tom Gilpatrick learned a lot about the Bronies by talking to Brony fathers, and also John DeLancey. And you know, I want to thank people like Tom Gilpatrick being a great father, because that's what his son was into. So let your son be into it. It's not hurting anybody. And it just seems like there's a lot of dads out there that, you know, they're just like, well, I don't want my son to be gay or whatever. And it's just like, that is worse than anything to a lot of dads. Like, being gay is the worst thing you could be.
Which is so silly. Basically, and what that's saying is, like, you know, in about 14, 15 years, your son's going to be more fun than most people.
Okay, yeah, I guess, but the point is, like, that, why is that the worst thing someone could be?
Yeah.
There's so much more, like, why, that's not even on the scale.
Like rather than, like, an emotionally repressed weirdo that will eventually kill people.
Exactly, because he can't express who he is, because he's, like, which is worse. So Tom Gilpatrick took Lyle, and at the end, the story wraps up nicely in the sense of Tom said, you know what? I'll give the show a chance. So Father Week, Tom Gilpatrick, you're a great guy.
I like that. That was a sentimental one.
Yeah. Yeah.
Our first real sentimental Father of the Week.
So sure, it's funny.
Tom
Gilpatrick.
Can I call him Tom?
Yeah, I'm sure Tom. You can call him Tom.
Nice.
But if there are any Bronies or Pegasisters out there, email in, isthatyourkid@yahoo.com. I want to talk to you, because I want to know what makes you tick. And I'm not going to pretend like I understand it, but that's okay. I respect you, and I respect it. And I just want to pick your brain to see what My Little Pony Friendship is Magic means to you. And that's my bit.
Okay. All right.
But you know what, though?
Hmm.
Back to the vodka facts.
Ooh. I nearly forgot about them.
If you put a dab of vodka on the tip of your cigarette, it will reduce post-cigarette bad breath. Oh. True or false?
Wow, you know, I think I've heard about this. False.
It's false. That one is not true. That's a good one, though, huh?
Yeah.
At Tito's Vodka. At Is That Your Kid. Tell us how you drink your Tito's Vodka. Rinse your razor in vodka. It not only cleans the blade, but what else does it do, Jake? It prevents from rusting.
Hmm.
Rinse your razor in vodka, no rust, and it cleans it, sterilizes it.
Maybe any alcohol that doesn't have sugar in it. True.
True. Straight edge people out there, they're buying their Tito's.
Straight edge people, you can put the vodka on your edges, and those edges might cut your hair.
You could sterilize your edges, baby.
On various parts of
your body.
You
heard it here first. Is that your kid.podomatic.com? Subscribe. Download, share, review.
Don't forget about business cards.
Don't forget about. I gave a business card to people at the show. I gave a business card to my nurse in the hospital. I'm getting the word out. Are they listening? No, but I'm doing it.
I left a business card at a diner.
Did you?
Yeah. I leave them sneaky. Like, just leave it. So, like, a random Joe or Jane might be like, what's this weird thing? And then throw it away.
We should start getting real creepy with it and just putting it in people's bags secretly.
Oof.
Jim Lee was doing that at Comic-Con with his drawings.
Weird? You know what's weird?
What?
I went to Kennywood.
I did see that.
Theme park. With the band. With
Kennywood
my marching
theme
band.
Park, yeah.
And because it's an amusement park with roller coasters, and it's like America's a wooden coaster outlet. On the East Coast, maybe. Mm-hmm. I'm making it up. But it's a nice park. Is it great? Maybe. But everyone seems to enjoy it here in Pittsburgh. So we were there. The marching band was going to play and march in the parade. So that's why we were there. When I got out, it's time to go home. I went to my car. And in my window, I thought I had a ticket.
Uh-oh.
So I get out. I'm like, oh, you know, crap. Mm-hmm. So I get out and I take what I thought was a ticket. And it's a business card for a Hungarian social club. Which I thought was weird because, A, did they know I was Hungarian and put it in there? Or was it just chance?
Yeah.
But I am Hungarian. I think I'm more Hungarian than anything else.
Maybe they looked up your license plate number on a mobile app and saw your last name, and that's when they slipped the card in. That's what I would do.
Seems like a lot of work.
That's what I would do, though. Just saying.
Well, it worked because I still have the card. I still have the business card. So maybe we should just put...
Where could we go? Do you want to do that in New York?
We'll just put them in people's windshields?
Look, we've got boxes in
We've
this.
Got like hundreds. We've got hundreds.
We could put these in fucking, like, what's it called? Windshield wipers.
That's what I'm saying.
Let's do that in New York.
That's what happened to me and it worked. I still have the car.
Yeah. And sure, maybe 9 in 10 people throw it away.
Write your phone number on the back of all of them.
And you could also use vodka as toner. It can reduce acne and pore size. Jake, is that true? Vodka fact.
You threw three at me at once.
Use vodka
as toner.
As toner.
Oh, I thought you...
For it could reduce pore size and acne.
No, when you said toner, I thought you meant like you could use it in your printer.
Maybe.
As toner.
I don't think you can. That'd be a false one.
That'd be a false one.
But toner as in
toner. Same goes with just alcohol in general and distilled 6 times for your health. It's got to work.
Distilled 6 times. It does work, Jake. True.
You hit me with a lot of truths.
Mm-hmm. So from, you know, East Coast to West Coast, I got you covered here with these vodka facts. And speaking of the West Coast, we know somebody on the West Coast, don't we? Maybe?
Like, is it a wino? Do they like wine?
No.
Is it?
Well, she may like wine.
I hope so. I like
she
wine.
May wi- Mike wine.
She like may wine. Like wine.
She way, way
you know
wine.
What? You know what my favorite time to drink wine is? It's in the fall. We're quickly approaching the fall.
We're quickly approaching the fall. Blah. Wrist cut. But.
What's your favorite season?
Summer.
Really?
Yeah, because everybody's more chilled out. And if you're more chilled out, I'm less likely to have a panic attack. Let's be real about it.
I think summer, fall, spring, summer, fall are my best. Do I hate winter? No. But I like do. Spring, summer, fall.
Dude, every time it snows, I want to cry. I hate it. I just don't want to deal with it.
I don't mind it.
I don't like wearing a bunch of clothes.
This winter sucked because it was forever.
Dude, this winter, the endless winter. We're still in winter, probably.
Do you think that, like, our months
all these
our
fucking flies will die in the winter?
And, like, the seasons are, like, out of sync with the months? Like...
Well, that's global warming.
Maybe, but maybe we aren't a political our calendar podcast. Is wonky and it got weird.
What if we did a political podcast?
Jeez, would we have to dress up for the podcast?
No.
Yeah, I feel like I'd be better at political stuff if I dressed up.
Well, you know, like, late night, a lot of people on late night will wear a pair of shorts, but the top of them will be, like, long sleeve, tie. You won't know what they're wearing under their desk. What? And there's been a few that just wear nothing. Not wear nothing, but, like, shorts.
You know what my dream would be? Have a conversation with Craig Ferguson.
He's leaving that show.
I know. Mm-hmm. It's very sad.
Yeah, I mean, I like him, I guess. I don't watch too much late night.
He's a late night guy that is a parody of late night guys.
Yeah.
He's a complete parody, and he understands.
He's very self-aware.
He's like the Is That Your Kid of late night.
He's the Is That Your Kid of late night. Or are we the Craig Ferguson of podcasts? Should I add that to the description? The Craig Ferguson of podcasts?
We're not charming enough. Craig Ferguson, if you've ever heard that
name. You're charming enough.
We're not
I'm
Scottish.
Not.
We're not Scottish. We're not Scottish enough.
We're Scottish.
We could be Scottish if we want to. Add that to the tags.
If we try.
Scottish.
We could be. If we wanted to be Scottish, I bet we could.
Scottish.
It's like, you know, it's like a wounded Scottish. Scottish.
I was going completely different.
We're from Scottish Wales instead of Cardiff Wales. Wales, though, in general, sick place. But from East Coast to West Coast, we bring you this podcast, and we do have a West Coast counterpart who often chimes in and sends some messages from the past to the future, and she's our West Coast time-traveling reporter.
So in the past she was trying to quit smoking, so in the present or the future she's probably already done smoking, but right now we're still getting the echoes of her
mm-hmm.
translucent
ideas.
Translucent ideas.
Yeah, translucent ideas. But Lulu from the West Coast, she is still struggling to quit smoking cigarettes as far as the past is concerned. And Lulu's a bit afraid this week, but I bring to you Lulu's smoking thought.
Hey kids, Lulu Row Time Questin here. Just smoking one of my post last cigarettes. I should have quit a couple of days ago, but I don't know. I'm kind of scared. I'm just gonna level with you. Like, I've been smoking off and on since I was 16. And there was a long period where I quit. But now, like, I love them. Like, my cigarettes and I have a weird relationship, which I guess any addict would say about some sort of substance that they have personified into something, you know. But I'm kind of scared to go the day without the cigarettes. Like, that's gonna be hard. I bought my little nicotine lozenges, so tomorrow will be my first Indiana Jones expedition towards not having one of my favorite things. Yikes. I don't know. I think everyone can relate. It's like having, you know, it's like when you first break up with someone, and then the day after, and you can't text them or you can't call them. That's what it's like. It's like they're right there, but you just can't touch them. I don't know if that makes sense, but that's kind of how I feel right now. I'm just kind of scared about giving up something, and it's so trivial. It's a fucking cigarette. It's not even like a person or career or anything. It's just fucking stupid. Anyway, struggling with myself, but being honest, so I'm smoking that.
So Lulu's having some hard times this week, Jake.
Well, she's got it.
I think she's got it.
And here's the thing. I think part of the reason that she agreed or to send these echoes into the future of these smoking thoughts is to be her support, sort of support program to hold her to not smoking. So I'll say this. You absolutely can't smoke again after you stop. Not after all this. You can't. And I think you know that.
Because this is recorded time, Lulu. So all the people who download our podcast know that you're trying to smoke. So I'm not saying that to scare you. I'm saying that to motivate you.
Yeah.
People know about you, and people want to see you stop smoking.
Here's the thing. You're allowed to be scared. That's okay.
Right.
But you're also allowed to quit, too. And I think you were well on your way. Making right. great progress.
And I think that's the same goes with this podcast. We're allowed to be scared, and we're allowed to quit. If we want. But that's okay.
Just find something else. I mean, I've smoked cigarettes, but there's no part of me that's just like, maybe it's just because I've been around people that have smoked them. And there's no part of me that's just like, man, I need another one. But that's just me. There's other things where I'm like, man, I really need that. And other people would be like, I don't need that at all. Right. So I can't say that I know where you're coming from because I don't. But
we all have our crutches. We all have our crutches.
But you don't need that crutch. You're like Tom Hanks in Forrest Gump when you're just like running out of his leg crutches, chasing and running.
Dude, that was deep.
You're just gonna break free, and soar like a
Lulu. Eagle. You soar like a Lulu.
I met another Lulu.
You met another Lulu.
I did. Lulu the clown.
Lulu the clown. East Coast Lulu.
Maybe.
Do we have an East Coast Lulu?
We might. We'll try to maybe get in contact with her. Yeah. She was making some pretty badass balloon animals.
So she's a clown.
Yeah, she is in fact Lulu the clown.
Lulu the clown.
She lives within 10 miles of us.
It sounds like that there's a lot to be said about the Lulu brand as a whole.
Yeah.
Like there's East Coast Lulu, West Coast Lulu. But from here on, I want to make like this the weirdest podcast ever. When I say weird, I don't mean that like internet term where every fucking thing you do is like, oh, isn't this weird and goofy? But I want to, like, let's interview some bronies, let's interview some clowns, like, let's do anything, like, put this as anything you want to do, let's put it on here.
Underdog internet.
I'd love to have her on the show at some point just to see how long she's been in the business. Maybe the biggest party, most favorite party, maybe the most favorite person that she's met in her line of work.
Yeah, you know what? She had left and I was walking to her to give her a card, a business card.
Oh,
she was gone. And I'm like, I was asking these kids, like, yo, where's Lulu the clown? And she's like, she left. I'm like, well, why didn't you stop her? And they looked at me weird, like they were supposed to know to stop her. They weren't. I just wanted to make them feel weird. I'm like, oh, that's
yeah,
okay.
Yeah, good call. Good call to make them feel I would have. But, you know, we're trying to reach out. I would love to have Lulu as a sponsor. Imagine if she did an intro for us. Like, Lulu the clown. This is Lulu the clown.
I'd love to hear some balloon noises.
Oh, dude. I my craned ass neck. I reached back and owed on that. I owed. I was like, oh. Like, to get like some balloon noises. Like, this is Lulu the clown. And you're listening to Is That Your Kid? And then maybe a clown horn noise.
I don't know if she has horns.
Maybe that's not her bit. She's like a new wave clown.
She doesn't need the full face paint. She does like minimalist face, which is great.
She doesn't need the tropes of being like, ooh.
She kind of looks like that. What was that one?
She's like an artist.
Like Lucy in the Big Red Couch. What was that show?
Oh.
She looks like that.
People are going to kill us that don't know.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Something in the
Big Red Couch. Hold on. I'll look it up real quick.
But anyway, she has that look. And it works. It works. She's making balloon animals. And she's made some pretty awesome Marios
the
and
big
Luigi's
comfy couch.
With, but what's it? Oh, it's just called the Big
Lunette the Clown.
Weird.
Lunette. Maybe she got, yeah. The Inspired. Big Comfy Couch is a Canadian children's television series about Lunette the Clown and her dolly, Molly, who solve everyday problems on their couch. It aired from 92 to 2006. Holy
That's
cow.
Way too long for a comfy couch. Holy shit.
Holy cow.
So,
I've not been comfortable for a day, let alone that many years. I've never been comfortable.
My favorite part of that show is, like, I feel like they had dust bunnies. I don't remember.
Yeah,
dust bunnies were the best part, because they were actual little dusty bunnies.
Yeah. Well, we've been through a lot. I mean, this was an action-packed episode. We covered a lot. We do have plans for next week, too. We're actually going to take a look at the Trans-Allegheny Lunatic Asylum. We actually got an email in from Dave H., which is what we call Dave Number One. He was at the Trans-Allegheny Lunatic Asylum. So go ahead and Wikipedia that or search it on the internet, because when we're in New York, we're going to get into that in-depth with our friends up there. And we were going to talk about it this week, but I thought it would be cool to just have a full table to talk about it.
I think that we can all research it and give our... Then we can have so many people...
Right, that's what I'm saying.
Vote on it.
That's right.
All
so
ghosts.
Is that your ghost, Haunted Towns? Coming live next week. Yukes and Zooks we didn't get to this week because I didn't get to practice because I left my ukulele at a friend's house.
But that's all right. We're in good shape.
So, but we're gonna still do that a bunch too. Thank you, Lulu, for your help. Now, what we want to get into, as I mentioned before, we are gonna feature some local bands. And so far, this volume, we've done a couple since we have a couple episodes. Casino Bulldogs, casinobulldogs.com. The Velcro Shoes, velcroshoes.bandcamp.com. Both new albums out this year. Fantastic. Friends with the Velcro Shoes. This week, we're going to feature another local band. They're called Action Camp. Now, Action Camp, I've seen them, probably a handful of times, maybe four or five times. And they've really adapted and changed their sound. And it's more of like an electro-pop synth kind of sound. They're a two-piece out of Pittsburgh. And their latest album is called PA. And it was inspired by man-made disasters in Pennsylvania history. You could hit them up at Action Camp just to say, yo, I heard you on Is That Your Kid? You guys were awesome. Or you could buy their album, which I did actually this morning, actioncamp.bandcamp.com. That's actioncamp.bandcamp.com. This is from that album, PA. It's called Turn of the Blade. This is by Action Camp. Hope you enjoy it. Crime.
traps that we bind. I've traced every line. A circle of tread. Say them again. Say them again.
Three bands, 3 weeks. If you want your band to be featured on the show, we still have a couple more queued up here. Is that your kid at yahoo.com? You could check us out at Is That Your Kid on Twitter. Again, talk to our partnership with at Tito's Vodka and tell them how you drink your Tito's. Subscribe on iTunes. Download, share, review, love, like, sort of. All that's fine with us. We appreciate your listen. And as per usual, I'd like to throw it over to my main man, Birdman Jr., the Angel Boy, the Dehydrated Martian, Jake, for some final thoughts on the episode.
Yo, New York, we're coming for you. That's pretty much it. I'm really excited to see New York City in its glory. Do some busking. Might try some of that.
Busking?
Busking, looking up. I'm not going to tell you what it is. That you're on your own.
Okay.
Looking to do some busking out there. Watch some shows. Have a great time with Todd. Ride that Muga bus.
Muga bus.
I can't wait to drink coffee in that bus and then immediately have to pee, but I'm going to do it anyway.
Mega bus has tables.
You do on a road trip. You drink a bunch of coffee and listen to your favorite music.
Good night. that was like the best story. Like, I could hear that over. Like, if you retold it, I'd still listen the second time. I loved it so much.